So, ladies and gentlemen, this is Enzo Palmieri from Legnaro. Unfortunately, I'm in Italy and I miss the conference, I miss Lanzhou, I miss China, I miss this beautiful congress very much. But I wanted to thank, take the opportunity to thank the International Advisory Committee for the possibility they allowed to me to present a video of the activity that my research group was actively doing last years. So,
on the abstract booklet you will find a more shy title, but we got good results, and in my opinion the right title is this one, The Way to Thick Films, The Way of Thick Films Toward the Flat Queuing Sputtered Cavities. A work performed in the framework of CERN-INFN collaboration for future circular colliders. So, the work refers to the usual 20 years old problem that niobium sputtered copper cavities are affected by a Q slope. So, at actual point of technology, the only possible cavities that can be used at a high accelerating field are bulk niobium cavities. We will propose in this talk the thick film way in order to attempt to try to this problem. The talk is divided in three parts, and the first part refers just to the question, why thick films? Let's start from one experimental evidence. Let's compare niobium sputtered cavities with niobium clad cavities. Niobium sputtered copper cavities display a Q-slope. Niobium explosively bond copper cavities have no Q-slope. That it means that the problem of Q-slope is inside the fabrication technology and not it's an intrinsic problem of the niobium copper system. Once stated that, let's analyze logically in what clad cavities differ from sputtered ones. Two factors. The niobium thickness, because in clad cavities it's how say, a kind of bulk-like material with high purity, high grain size, high RRR, and niobium interface, because in case of clad cavities the interface is possibly interdiffused material one inside each other. So, how the niobium thickness could affect RF performances? There are three possible mechanisms. The first mechanism, it's reported in one of my papers presented in Cornell in 2005, where from fundamental theoretical consideration, I reported that the superconducting gap is decreased by the velocity of superelectrons. If you have high velocity of your superfluid, that means a high current or a high accelerating field, there is a gap depression. And the velocity of superfluid depends on the fraction of superelectrons. How does the percentage of superelectrons depends from RRR? Yes, it's a fundamental concept that the fraction of superelectrons depends from the ratio of mean free path over the coherence length. And mean free path is equivalent to RRR. Now, when the superconducting electron fraction, when the fraction of superelectrons will not depend anymore from L or from RRR, at L over Xi, that is over 10, that means more or less RRR more than 50, better more than 100. So there is a theoretical argument that says that if you don't want to if you want to get rid of Q-slope, you must have at least RRR at least more than 50. Can a high niobium thickness provide RRR more than 100? Yes, there are a plethora of reasons. Two reasons is that a large thickness has a larger grain growth. And if you have a larger grain size, you have a larger RRR. Another one is that you can have impurities diffused from the interface, from the niobium copper interface. If you have a small thickness, the top layer reached by RF field will be immediately reached by impurities. If you have a very large thickness, the diffusion of impurities from the interface will be much, much slower. Second possible physical mechanism has been suggested by Sergio Calatroni from CERN. He says that in thin films, in case of the defected interface, the thermal flow propagates unidimensionally because the thickness is very small, and so it's blocked by the defect. In thick films, the thermal flow instead is more three-dimensional, so it shunt the defect, propagating from top niobium layer to the copper interface, through the copper interface to the helium with much higher efficiency, because all the heat, it shunt the defects. A third possible physical mechanism, it's just the one that we heard from the previous talk from Giorgio Vaglio. The niobium copper interface is responsible of the Q-slope. The quality of interface, of course, depends on film stress. Even more if niobium and copper are not miscible. And niobium and copper are not miscible at all up to temperatures of the level of 1100 degrees centigrade. Now, only if the film is absolutely not stressed, one can be sure to deposit a thick film that will be adherent to the interface. Otherwise, there is no any possibility. If you are able to do a thick film that is adherent to the interface, you will be sure that it has zero stress. Hence, there are different considerations pushing to try thick films rather than niobium films. Because, at the end, thick films imply higher purity and better interface. So, let's pass now to the part 2, the experimental part, the experimental procedure. We just said that a better niobium-copper interface will be achieved for a stress-free film. So, what are the main parameters ruling stress? The sputtering parameters ruling the stress are mainly three: substrate temperature, substrate pressure, and film thickness. The role of substrate temperature is the most simple. The higher temperature will be, the lower the stress will be. That's simple. Referring instead to the argon pressure, the situation is a bit more complex. There is a critical pressure when the stress passes from tensile to compressive. And if we want zero stress films, this is the point that we should look for. What it means a stress compressive rather than a tensile? As soon as you deposit your film onto a substrate, opposite forces will appear at the interface. The substrate is stronger than film. So, in case of tensile stress, the substrate will tend to put the film in tension. In case of compressive stress, instead, the substrate will tend to compress the film. A useful method to see if your film is stressed or not consists in depositing niobium onto a thin substrate like, for example, Kapton, or also a very thin, extremely thin sapphire. But mean Kapton is okay. And then you go to see in which direction the Kapton is bent. Of course, if you have no stress, the Kapton will remain flat. The third parameter is the film thickness. There is a critical thickness where the stress passes from compressive to tensile. If you want a zero stress film, the thickness must not be smaller or larger than that. Let's say that it must be exactly that. So, the idea is that if zero stress films are only possible at low thickness, a multilayer of 1000 zero stress monolayers will also be a zero stress film. We tried to put in practice this idea and we saw that it works. We can get films, hundreds of microns thick, showing no stress. So, the idea is to deposit a thin layer of few hundred nanometers, then you stop the process for 30% of the time. I mean, we choose a 30% of the time, but you can modulate between 20, 40, I mean, you can choose your renormalization time. You give to the film the time to renormalize, the time to do a kind of self-annealing. Then you go to deposit a new layer on the old one, and so on for thousands and thousands of times, as in atomic layer deposition. We built an automatic program that switches voltage up and down with a renormalization time of variable that we fixed to 30%. This is the scheme of how we built our multilayer. This is the program. And these are the parameters that we investigated. We did films at always at 70 microns thick. We did the cavities 70 microns thick with different single layer thicknesses, so 100, 300, 400 and 500 nanometers. So this is an example of a 10 micron film. You can see microstructure. This is a film 468 microns thick, half millimeter, but recently we have spattered films that are 1.2 millimeter thick. There is no limit to the thickness. So, once found such an original method, we applied it to the film deposition inside cavities. And this is described in part 3 of the presentation, that one of experimental results. The first cavities we deposited were sputtered in one shot by optimizing substrate temperature of the order of 600 degrees centigrade and argon pressure, but not applying the multilayer approach. The typical result was a cavity with a certain slope that if we bake at low temperature increases its performances, but nothing else. After a certain number of cavities, then we have applied the multilayer approach, depositing cavities always 70 microns thick, but with a single layer thickness of different size, like 100, 300, 400 and 500 nanometers. We must think that the single layer thickness cannot be too thin, because the superconducting properties increase with thickness, because I mean, we say the increased grains and so on, but the single layer cannot be too large, because otherwise the stress will increase. So we must find we must look for a compromise. So this in the graph are four different 70 microns thick cavities deposited at various single layer thicknesses of 100, 300, 400 and 500 nanometers. And the result is that in figure. Then we measure the cavity and we extract the Q-slope that we can plot as a function of single layer thickness, showing a very nice trend. That means that the Q-slope can be modulated playing on the thickness of single elementary layer. But if the cavity is mechanical, without defects, perfectly electropolished, and all parameters are optimized, flat Q-curves are then possible. And in these slides, we see the first encouraging results that we got. And in the next graph, we see that flat Q-cavities come more and more often. So, in conclusion, we have seen that by thick film approach we can get flat Q cavities. But, at the end, does this talk advise to develop thick film cavities instead of thin films? Not at all. Thick films are only the way, not the final target. Thick films, in our intention, are the way to understand the mechanism. Our future strategy consists in optimizing the thick film approach, but then, once the optimization is done, to try to reduce the thickness from 70 microns to 40 microns, 30 microns, 20 microns, 10 microns, and so on, in order to arrive again to thin film cavities. In conclusion, my friends and colleagues, I wish you all the best in this extraordinary conference. My colleagues Ruggero Vaglia and Christian Pira now in the audience are available for questions on this talk, because I am absent. Of course, I am absent, otherwise I would have not sent this video. Referring to me, I want to give appointment to the Thin Film Workshop, or Thick Film Workshop, depends on, in Legnaro next year. There I will expect hot discussion about Finn or Fic Films. Referring to now, I wish you all the best and a wonderful conference. Bye.